thought that those guys had really zero chance against Brock Lesnar, Daniel Bryan included. Mm-hmm. But after the match, we all said, wow, at points of this match, we actually believe that they had a shot at beating him. And I don't see why either one of these guys, including Kings, could be beating him.
Here's my thing. I think it would be a refreshing match between Kofi and Brock Lesnar. It's something that I think a lot of us would like to see. But for me personally, I have, you know, this deep following.
Mr. Two, what's wrong?
I don't like the way, so much way, how he beat Brock Lesnar. I think he beat him off
no,
in a cheap
no,
shot.
No, no, no,
and
no,
Seth
no, no more. Because I fixed that already, and I fixed that one too. And the other nurse came in here. No, we're leaving like that. We cannot be coming back in here, close, open, no.
Heroes don't resort to
okay?
Yeah, exactly. And I don't understand this mentality.
The earlier you wanted me to open it, I open it. That one you want me to close, and there's nothing really to close. And you call the other nurse?
All right, let's move on to the U.S. Championship. Mysterio, he is interested against the vacating the title. What does this mean for Rey Mysterio? What does this mean for the United States Championship?
Well, you're fine right now. I'll be back at 8 o'clock to fix you. Okay?
Again, under controversial circumstances. Because as we saw in several
replays, half an hour. Okay? I'll be back.
The title should go back to the person that had it previously. I mean, it's more exciting that maybe have a little tournament and have some people fight for that position. But at the same time, the champion that Ray won it from should get back to Jeff Ray.
Yes.
Well, I think I like tournaments because I'm a big old King of the Ring guy. So while Joe does deserve it back, there are other deserving people on the roster who deserve a shot at this. So I don't see why we don't have a tournament. Whoever wins that faces Joe.
Oh, okay.
So for me, two of the guys in that tournament who have been knocking it out of the park the last 2 weeks, Cesaro and Ricochet. Cesaro and Ricochet have been murdering these matches on Monday Night Raw. They've been one of the best things on the show the last few weeks. I don't see why those two and maybe a couple other guys can get into a tournament, and whoever wins that tournament fights Samoa Joe.
I really love that.
Reasons.
And I'm with you, Jimmy. I wasn't ready to see Samoa Joe out of the picture yet because I think that he is just on another level.
Let's get the kid in there. Ray's kid.
Oh, Dominic?
Let's get Dominic in there, too. Put Dominic in the tournament.
Maybe a tad too soon.
No.
So we have Rey Mysterio injured. Ruby Riott's been going through injury. Big E, AJ Styles. These are all prominent superstars, you know, prominent in the main roster that have been getting TV time, who have had opportunities at a title match. And now they have to take a step back due to injury. What does this mean for them at this moment and, you know, the WWE landscape overall?
It really throws off your momentum. Mm-hmm. I really consider Ruby Riott to be one of the shining stars of the women's division. She's had so many high-profile and awesome matches against other female superstars on the roster. It really slows down your momentum. You're going someplace, and then that's kind of torn up from under you. It also goes to show what having no off-season does. Mm-hmm. You don't get a chance to rest. Your body just gets worn down and torn apart day after day after day.
I love that you say that, because we talk about athletes in certain sports who have, you know, very minimal time in the off-season, but WWE wrestlers don't have an off-season. They are, you know, 320-plus days a year training in and out. Like, that's insane.
It's a 52-week-a-year business, and, you know, for some reason, we're in tune today. I don't know what's going on, because I was thinking that exact same thing, that unlike other sports, you don't have that time to recuperate. Your time off is your time in between tour days, which is like a day or two.
Yeah.
So it's really rough, and it's just a rough schedule. You're going to go through this, especially in this industry, that injuries are going to catch up, and this just happens to be a time where they seem to be more prominent with more prominent superstars on the roster. That being said, people are complaining that these guys have been in their spots for a long time. Let's see some new people come up.
Yeah.
Unfortunate circumstances, but this is a chance for somebody to step up.
That door closes, another door opens.
Exactly.
Okay, Nuck, I want you to take this away because you're a big fan. What did you think of Dolph Ziggler's return?
You know what? It's really tough for me because I do love The New Day and Kofi, but to see Ziggler come back, I got very excited. And then to hear his promo after on SmackDown and again on Monday, Dolph Ziggler's knocking it out of the park. It might be the same kind of thing we've heard from Dolph Ziggler a lot, but it really fits, and he's really focused on getting that title away from Kofi Kingston.
It's genuine.
Yeah.
It is genuine. It's like Steve Austin used to say it all the time. The best personas on television are the ones that are themselves cranked up the throttle. And that's what Dolph Ziggler is doing.
but as you know, we're going to get some quality options. I can't wait for this.
I know, it'll be exciting. Okay, if you Aftermath TV fans head over to sportsnet.ca, there's an excellent read, a big read on the legacy of China. And I strongly encourage, you know, all you Aftermath TV fans, you WWE fans, to head over and read this because, one, it is very well written. Two, it kind of talks about how she challenged the stereotypes of, you know, the female WWE superstars and how she was able to come into her own and really set a new bar in WWE for wrestlers and female wrestlers. And I want you guys to talk a little bit more about it because I know that you're ingrained a lot in China.
Well, this is a very weird thing to talk about on television, but when I was in university, I wrote a paper on the performance of gender in professional wrestling. And China was a big part of that paper that I wrote. I had said, if you are a very feminine woman or a very manly man, the wrestling audience loves you. But if you challenge that at all, the fans don't know what to do. China showed up, and the fans didn't know what to do. They loved her because she was physical and could actually compete with the men, but they didn't know what to do with her because she didn't look very feminine. They didn't know what she was. They didn't understand what was happening. And soon, after she came in and showed some personality, got in the ring and started to compete, the fans just immediately loved her.
And I love hearing that because back then, you know, she was challenging the norms. But nowadays, you know, we look at a woman like China and we're like strong, athletic, capable, you know. And it's interesting to see her, you know, someone, China, if she were to be in this day and age, back then, she was already earning that respect. Mm-hmm. And she paved the way. She paved the way for a lot of female and, you know, male superstars.
That's exactly what it is. Because there was this stereotype attached to women's wrestling back in the day. China not only broke the mold, she just trashed it and threw it all away. And she did it in such a way where, you know, we talk about the women's evolution now and where it's gone and where it is right now. Without China, I don't think it gets there. You can name names like Trish Stratus and Lita, and all respect to them, they were very instrumental in moving the women's movement forward. But without China, that doesn't happen. She was such a different person. She was a sweetheart too, by the way, just so you don't know it. And again, she broke the mold.
Talk to me about her drive. You know, what made her different in her headspace and her mentality that set her apart and that helped her pave that road?
She didn't allow herself to be stereotyped as the female talent. She was one of the first females to say, hey, I am a WWE or WWF at the time superstar. I am not a female superstar. And she stood out from the pack. And I love the fact that it wasn't rushed. They let her debut as a bodyguard type of thing, which you don't see, you know, women in those traditional roles of a bodyguard. And she was guarding guys like Triple H and DX and stuff like that. And she was just way ahead of her time. And I can only imagine if she were to be in the WWE today, she would be maybe the biggest superstar in the country.
And the effect she had on being an inspiration to people who are wrestling now, not just men and women, but your LGBTQ wrestlers, your trans wrestlers, all of those people saw somebody breaking the mold, wanting to do that, wanting to get out of that pigeonhole,